Hello participants, I am Mayank Gautam and I am going to present a demonstration on VLC uplink based on RF frequency. In this presentation, I will be covering these points, which includes basic information about VLC uplink followed by the design implementation goals and solutions. I will also discuss the overview of VLC uplink design followed by some demonstration videos. Now, let me provide a brief overview of VLC uplink. So, using VLC communication system, one can transmit video, voice and data just like any other communication system using visible light spectrum, but only in one direction, that is downlink. Therefore, in order to provide bidirectional data transfer in a VLC communication system, VLC uplink is implemented, which can be developed using RF or IR technology. Here, I am going to present the VLC uplink implementation using RF technology. Before going towards the design implementation, let me talk about some of the challenges, or I should say requirements, we need to fulfill. First of them is high data rate. The design should be able to transmit and receive data at higher speeds. Along with that, the communication should be reliable at all time and at longer distances also. Next is the compatibility. The design should be compatible with all the hardware used in this project. Let me give you an example. In the LiFi project, we are using ZCU102 board as the main component around which our entire project will work. So, the design should be implemented in such a way that every component used by the VLC uplink is made compatible with the ZCU102 board. Next up is the ease of integration. The VLC uplink design needs to be flexible enough so that it can easily integrate with other parts of the LiFi network projects. To explain this, let's consider VLC uplink access to the LiFi MAC layer. The MAC layer needs an easy integration with the VLC uplink design in order to transmit and receive packets over the link. This brings us to the fourth point, which is usability of the design. The implementation should be able to provide easy to use interface, something like an abstraction layer in form of an API to simplify the usage of the design. Now, let's move towards some of the solutions accepted in order to achieve the desired goals. For ensuring high data rate of the link, PCI Express protocol is selected as the interface between the RF frontend and the ZCU102 board. Talking about the compatibility of the PCI protocol with the ZCU102 board, the ZCU102 board offers a high-speed PCI root port Gen 2 4 lanes which can be used by the RF frontend. The RF frontend is also a PCIe 2-lane supported dual band module which works at 2.4 GHz and 5 GHz frequency spectrum. The RF frontend module also supports on-chip OFDM and QAM 256 modulation technology. Now, both the devices which are ZCU102 board and the RF frontend module are interface compatible with each other, which is the PCIe interface. But in order to make this work, a custom kernel is developed which helps the two devices to communicate with each other. The custom kernel is developed over a fork of Xilinx kernel repository, which is provided by the Xilinx for ZCU102 board. Also, a custom software platform is developed to provide a simple user experience and ensure ease of integration with other parts of the project. The software platform works as a middleware between the kernel and the user application, which will be presented in this demonstration. This block diagram shows the architecture of the VLC uplink design implementation. The communication between the ZCU102 board will be handled by the RF frontend module, which acts as a physical layer device for the VLC uplink. The frontend module and the processor system, also known as PS part of the ZCU102 board, are interfaced using the PCIe slot available on the ZCU102 board. The PCIe driver for the RF frontend module is incorporated in the custom kernel of the operating system. The driver is responsible for providing the basic application programming interface for the RF frontend module. The application programming interface provides handler for controlling and configuring the frontend module. The custom kernel also provides an interface for accessing the driver functions from the Linux user space. On booting the ZCU102 board, the custom kernel will load the PCIe drivers and creates an interface at the Linux user space, which acts as an endpoint for communicating with the RF frontend module. The application is developed for the Linux platform and runs on the Linux user space as the user application. The application provides a command line user interface for controlling and communicating with the frontend module. To summarize, the VLC uplink design comprises of three major components. A Linux user application for the users to control and communicate with the link interface. A custom kernel which provides the link interface between the user application and the PCIe driver. The PCIe driver, as the name suggests, drives the RF frontend module, which is the physical layer device of the VLC uplink. This ends the basic explanation of the RF-based VLC uplink design implementation. Now, let's move forward towards the demonstration of the VLC uplink. The VLC uplink demonstration is developed using these components, which includes a ZCU102 Zynq UltraScale MPSoC development board, which is a high-performance hexa-core processor coupled with a Xilinx 16-nanometer programmable logic fabric. The ZCU102 board is interfaced with a dual-band 2.4 GHz and 5 GHz supported RF frontend module. This demo also requires a SD card prepared with the necessary files required to boot and run the demo on the ZCU102 board. The boot files, which includes basic ZCU102 board files, a custom kernel, and user application. All these files are developed using Xilinx provided PetaLinux software development kit, also known as PetaLinux tools. This setup consists of two identical parts, as you can see here. Talking about the individual parts, each part includes a ZCU102 development board with which the RF frontend module is connected via PCIe port. A SD card is inserted in the SD card slot of the ZCU102 board. This SD card is preloaded with the entire software stack developed for the demonstration, which includes Linux operating system, custom kernel, and the user application programs. The ZCU102 board is also equipped with a monitor connected via DisplayPort to provide output from the operating system and a keyboard to take input to the operating system. The keyboard is connected to the USB Type-B port using an USB adapter. The other part of the setup is connected in the same manner as the part I have just explained. This summarizes the hardware setup overview. Now, in order to work with the setup, we need to configure the software part also. First, we need to start the server on the first board, which will start advertising itself to the other board, so that the other device can establish a connection with the server in order to communicate with each other. The software is easy to use and operate the desired functionality of the device using the command line interface. So, all the commands that are programmed can be viewed by using this command. All the commands are displayed and explained on the console window. Now, to start the connection server, this command is used. This command requires some mandatory arguments, which are server name to which the device will request connection to, and a code which authenticates the connection request. In our case, I will be using uplink as the server name and 12345678 90 as the code for authenticating the connection request. The command will start the advertisement server and also assign an unique ID to the device, which will reference to the board for sending and receiving data on the link. As you can see, the program will show the ID allotted to the server board. Now, once the advertisement server is started, we can connect the other board to the server using this command. This command also requires some mandatory arguments, which are server name to connect to and the authentication key which is set on the server board. After successful connection, the board is allotted with a unique ID for board reference, which is 250. With this, the setup is configured to communicate with each other. Coming to the demonstrations, our first demonstration is to test the data rate of the link. To overview this demo, we are going to start a testing server on board 1 and connect this server from board 2. To clarify this, test server is different from the advertisement server we created earlier. This server runs on port 5201. After that, software will start transmitting a random data for an interval of 10 seconds, and after each second, it will calculate and displays the data rate the link is operating at. Let's see it in action. As the link is already connected and both the devices are allotted a board ID, we are going to use this command on board 1 with ID 159 to start the test server. This requires no argument. Now the server is started at port 5201. Now on the second board, we are going to start the test using this command. Note this command requires an argument which specifies the board ID of the board with which we are going to perform the test, which is in our case is 159. Now the random data transmission is started, and after 1 second interval, data rate is calculated and displayed on the screen. At the end of the transmission, the average speed is calculated and displayed, which comes out to be around 100 Mbps. To verify, the receiver speed is displayed at the server side also. To summarize, what we have done here is first we connected two boards with each other, then started a test server on board 1 and acquires a board ID to reference it to the board. On board 2, we started the test by providing the board ID of the board we need to perform the test with. The testing program transmits a random data, calculates the data rate, and displays it in our console window. Next up is the test transfer demonstration. In this demonstration, the first step is to connect the two boards and acquire the board IDs. The process has been already discussed in previous slides. After that, the text receiver application is started on board 1, and on board 2, text transmitter application will be started. Now, on the text transmitter application which is running on board 2, the tab text is transmitted to the receiver application on board 1. The receiver application on board 1 displayed the text on the console window. Let's see it in action. Here both devices are connected with each other and board IDs are allotted to both the boards. Now on board 1, this command will be used to start the text receiver program, which will wait for the text reception from the other devices. Once the data is received, it will be displayed here. Now, on the second board, we will use this command to start the text transmission program. The command requires the board ID of the board we are transmitting the data to. Now, type the text followed by the enter key to transmit it. Let's say we type hello world and send it. Here, the text received and displayed on the first board. Let's try another text string. Say, this is Li-Fi demo, and send it to the board 1. This is the text transfer demo. To summarize what we have done here, first we connected the two boards, acquires board ID. On board 1, started the text receiver program, and on board 2, started the text transmission program. After that, on board 2, we tap the text and transmits it. This brings us to the last demonstration, which is video transfer demonstration. The process is similar, which follows connection of two boards and board ID acquisition. Next up, on board 1, a video stream is started, which will be playback on the other device using the VLC uplink. The process of streaming the video includes creation of RTPS server and using the server to stream the desired video file. The video playback is executed by providing the board ID of the device on which the stream is transmitting. Let's jump on to the demo. So here the boards are connected and board IDs are assigned. Now, the board 1 with ID 159, we will use this command. This command is used to start the stream and it requires the path of the video file to transmit. The SD card connected on the ZCU102 board includes a text video file in MP4 format on the file system, which we are passing to the program in order to transmit it. Now the program is starting our RTPS server and parallelly playing the transmitted frames. Now, on the receiver side, we will be starting the playback using the video receiver program. The command also requires the board ID of the transmitter. Now, the receiver program will start playing the received video frames. As you can see, the transmitted frames are lagging behind the received frames. This is happening due to the fact that video transmitter program is playing the video frames after transmitting them. On the other hand, the receiver program is playing the video frames as soon as it receives the frame. Now, let me stop the transmission of the video file. The receiver program stops playing the frames as it no longer receives any data. Now, let me stop the receiver playback and notice the receiver program enters a looping condition which retries receiving the data from the same transmitter, but it fails to do so as we stop the transmitter program, which also stops the RTPS server. Now if I restart the video transmission, the receiver starts receiving the video frames again and plays them on the display. The video file we are transmitting is a full HD video which requires a high data rate in order to be played without delay and without any frame skips. The video transmission program transmits the video in looping mode, means it never stops transmitting until we manually stops it. The board ID allotment is used in order to connect multiple receivers, which helps isolating and distinguishing between the devices during the reception and transmission of the data. To summarize the video data transmission demonstration, the process includes connection of two devices followed by the acquisition of unique board IDs, after which on board 1 a RTPS server and video transmission is started. On the second board, the video receiving is started from the transmitter and a video playback is shown on the monitor. That's all for the VLC uplink demonstration. Thank you.